Namaste, everyone. I'm Prachi Mishra. I'm a graduate student of public policy at ISPP, Harris School of Public Policy at the University of Chicago. I have been working with the highest echelons of polity, Indian polity, for over 3 years now, and most of my work has been centered around data science and public policy. I usually keep track of ongoing technological developments and how they will impact the Indian society and economy at large. I recently joined the Infinity Foundation as a graduate student intern and got familiar with Sri Rajiv Malhotra's new book on artificial intelligence and the implications it will have on India. Like all of his other phenomenal works, the book brings to surface fascinating insights. It's almost like a wake-up call for all of us. Taking this conversation forward, I'm going to interview Sri Malhotra about his book, about his views on artificial intelligence and the future and what it holds for the future, and his vision for the youth of India. Welcome, sir. Congratulations on your new book.
Namaste. I just want my viewers to know that Prachi is a good example of the kind of people we want to mentor. A very brilliant person. She has a computer science background, but she's now applying it to public policy, pursuing an advanced degree in the University of Chicago. And as she mentioned, she is working with the highest echelon of the Indian government on this particular issue of public policy concerning AI, data sciences, all these kind of things. So she's the perfect person that I decided when she showed interest, I decided that I should accept her as an intern and mentor her. So here we are. I'm delighted because the kind of discussions she's had with me offline, the kind of inquisitiveness she showed, the kind of understanding of the serious issues that she shows, tells me that this is the voice of our youth that we want to encourage. And so I hope that not only the youth will learn from this, but I think most grown-ups will learn, because AI is an area where some of the young people know more. I'll be very honest with you. And so here is Prachi. Wonderful to see you. So let's get started.
Before I begin with the questions, I'll just say that the book is really nicely structured. We all know the global discourse on AI, it's fractured, it's dispersed, it's sparse, it's scattered, and it's limited to certain sections of the society. You beautifully classify the entire discourse on AI into five major areas which will come into conflict when AI becomes mainstream. And you've called these conflicts as battlegrounds. It seems like we'll be at war or at yuddha with AI when it becomes widely accepted and adopted. Before I begin a conversation on these five battlegrounds, there's a quite general question I want to ask. Since its advent, AI has been seen as the savior which will rescue people, societies, governments, economies out of all their miseries. But in your book, you've provided a contrary view. So could you please share your thoughts on why, if AI is adopted in the present state of India, it will bring more problems than benefits?
Well, you know, I'm not saying it will bring more problems necessarily, but it will disrupt society. I want to say that whenever there's an equilibrium, which means many forces are balanced, there's a dynamic equilibrium, many things are in balance, something new comes, it disrupts the equilibrium. A new technology will always disrupt the equilibrium, because some people will use it better than others. Some has more access to it than others. It may create some jobs for some people, lose jobs for others. So the disruption of Indian society or any country's society is going to happen. So it's not just the case that everything goes hunky-dory like before and problems get solved, but there is no disruption. That's not the case. The foundations of Indian society, politics, economics, education, industry, defense, all of these will be disrupted by AI. So it may be good stuff that will happen, and it may be some not so good stuff will happen. But to deal with a disruption is a challenge. You have to be understanding it. It's a new game. It's like the old chess game has been replaced by a new game. So now you need to learn new rules. So that's the wake-up call, is that our leaders and all sections of society have to be re-educated in this thing. This is the new game, and we have to learn how to play it.
Okay, so you've just mentioned about creation of jobs, or maybe the employment sector in general. So that's one fundamental area which needs attention. Some experts claim that AI will lead to creation of millions of jobs. Some other experts who are rather skeptical of AI, they say that, okay, AI will take away a lot of jobs. So what is your take on this? Is the Indian economy ready for AI?
So AI will create millions of jobs and AI will also take away millions of jobs. Both are true. Question is, will it create jobs in the rich areas or poor areas? Will it be people in Bangalore who are highly educated getting jobs? And will it be that poor people in Bihar will lose the jobs? So, you know, you could have 1 million new jobs and 1 million old jobs gone and yet have a big disruption. Because it's not the average that matters. The point is every local village has to be looked on its own way. Some villages, some towns, districts are dependent on certain economies, certain sectors, certain occupations, which might not be viable anymore. And they, as far as they're concerned, the problem will be serious. And in some other places, maybe new jobs will be created. So you have to look at the impact of AI on a district by district level. This has not been done. There are certain regions, certain states that will be devastated because what they are manufacturing will not be viable. And some other states will get new jobs. This depends on where the AI talent is available, where the new industries are created. So let me just give you an example on a global scale. If driverless cars become very popular, a few million people, maybe tens of millions of people around the world, in Africa, Latin America, India, various places in the United States, will lose jobs. A lot of drivers will lose jobs. But then new jobs will be created by Tesla and various driverless car manufacturers. But the location of the new jobs created will not be the same place where the old jobs are destroyed. So if I'm a driver in some small town in USA and I lose my job, it doesn't do me any good that some other guy in Silicon Valley got a new job. If I lose my old job and somebody else gets a new job, it doesn't help me that they got a new job. So the disruption of jobs is going to happen because the impact of AI is so severe in creating new industries, destroying old industries. Let me give you an example. In before iTunes and other ways of downloading music, there used to be a music industry where you would go and buy a CD or a DVD. Yeah. And there was a record chain in USA called Sam Goody's. Sam Goody's was there were tens of thousands of Sam Goody's. Every store, every corner, every market had a Sam Goody's, and you would go there and buy your records, buy your music. Now, with iTunes, a new industry was created, a new way of publishing your music. And all the old record labels like RCA Records, Columbia Records, Sony Records, they took a big hit. They took a very big hit, and the Sam Goody's and other retail stores took a big hit. So a whole old ecosystem destroyed, vanished. And iTunes created a new ecosystem with new jobs. So Apple got a lot of new jobs. And other people like Apple in the download business got new jobs. So there was a disruption, although there was overall new jobs also created. So that's the impact of AI on jobs that I'm foreseeing.
So this almost sounds like the gap between haves and have-nots will widen in some sense. So what is your take on that?
Yeah, one of the things I mentioned in this book a lot is that there will be new haves and new have-nots. The biggest people in wealth terms, all these Zuckerberg and all these Eric Schmidts and all these guys, they were not among the richest 20 years ago. Many of them are new people. And the previous list of very rich people are no longer that rich. Look at companies. Look at companies. Even IBM has gone down in its ranking. Exxon. General Motors. So entirely new companies are the $1 trillion market cap companies. There are new haves and new have-nots. This has always been the case. You look at any disruption. When the Industrial Revolution happened in Britain, a lot of old jobs were destroyed and new jobs were created and a new economy was created. But the people who got the new jobs were in Manchester, places like that in England. And the people who lost the old jobs were in India. A lot of steel manufacturing in India disappeared. A lot of textile manufacturing in India disappeared. So there were new haves and have-nots. But the new haves tended to be British people and the new mm-hmm. poor people tended to be Indians. So it is a problem. This is going to be earth shattering, and you will see social issues, social uprisings, political uprisings, more Breaking India forces, because certain villages which are held in balance will no longer be able to make ends meet. Many migrant workers will be affected. Many migrant workers, tens of millions will be affected. So their village economies will be affected. So I think India needs to study the impact of AI, not top down, like PwC has done, FICCI and CII and Cooper, Ernst & Young, many such people are doing. That's great. I like that also. But people need to do the impact of AI bottom up at the grassroots level. Each district has its own microeconomy of some kind. What would be the impact of AI at that level? Every state government should be doing studies on AI to make sure that they're going to be okay.
We've seen in this year of coronavirus pandemic that both US and China have been competing for the top slot. Do you think AI will play a dominant role in this race? And are the other countries in the developing world, in Asia and Africa, are they vulnerable to neo-imperialism and neo-colonialism?
So I have a whole chapter on what I call digital colonization and the recolonization of the world. And I have talked about US and China trade war is actually based on AI, because China was behind US until it decided to leapfrog ahead using AI. Using AI as the technology, it decided to leapfrog. It made that announcement over a decade ago. And a lot of intellectual property has been stolen. The US is convinced. And the Chinese, of course, in denial. So this transfer of AI technology from US to China is what allowed China to leapfrog ahead. Until then, the US felt that, okay, China is developing, but they'll be low tech, medium tech. And even when they aspire to be high tech, they'll still lag behind us. But AI gave them an opportunity to leapfrog. So now US is suddenly very concerned that in defense, China is catching up in terms of drones and robots. In many areas, China is on par with the United States. In some areas, it's ahead of the United States. If you go to AI conferences, sometimes the largest contingent of AI papers is from China. And a fact is that the largest amount of patents are being filed from China. The largest amount of references to top papers are Chinese papers. So the research in China is going very strong. They've taken over the American knowledge and then started building on top of it. So this is the basis for the US-China conflict. They mm-hmm. talk about 5G and they talk about other things. Those are important.
Yeah.
But this particular thing is at the foundation of all that. And it's made China very tough, brave, audacious, even rash, reckless in some ways, and arrogant, because China is convinced that it's cracked this AI thing. And it is so far is trying to move ahead of everybody else in AI. Certainly, China is ahead of India, maybe by as much as a decade. So the geopolitics has shifted. AI has caused a disruption in geopolitics. And when I talk about AI in this book, I'm not talking only about AI algorithms and machine learning. I'm talking about all the applications to robotics, to drones, to semiconductors, and the role of semiconductors combined with AI, quantum computing combined with AI. I'm talking about drug discovery. So I'm talking about the efficiency of automation, factories, social harmony and hacking societies with AI algorithms. So I'm talking not only about just pure AI itself, but all the ways that AI links with other technologies and other areas, other disciplines. This is going to change geopolitics. I predict that just like Britain and France were competing for colonies, 200 years ago, yeah. They were competing for colonies. Yeah, yeah. They were having wars. The Dutch East India Company, the French East India Company, the Danish East India Company, the British East India Company, etc., were fighting each other for territory. And there were wars in India between French soldiers and British soldiers and Dutch soldiers and all that going on. I predict that US and China are going to become imperial powers. China is already grabbing Africa, Latin America, large parts of Latin America. US is mm-hmm. woken up and saying, we also got to get going on this. So I see that neither of them wants to be second to the other. They will each have their own colonies and territories. So, for example, Pakistan is already a Chinese colony, is my belief. China would like to turn Nepal into a Chinese colony. China is going to bring out a lot of money and assistance to places like Iran. And squeezing Iran and Pakistan in between is Afghanistan. And with the withdrawal of U.S. troops and India not having access to the ocean directly into Afghanistan, it's very difficult in the long run to protect Afghanistan from falling into this. And China is the one that stands to gain a lot. And so I think the superpower war, the clash of superpowers, is a clash of colonial powers of the future. And each of them is going to claim colonies. The question my book raises is, where is India? How robust is India? If you do a stress test on India's resilience, where does India end up? That's what the book is asking the thought leaders of India to do.
Which leads to another fascinating question. What changes do you anticipate in the policy landscape of India? Where do you see the political and economic systems of India going? Where are they going?
That's something you should tell, because you're working in the top level of Indian government policymaking. You would know better. I am an outsider. I have not been consulted. I have not been brought in to. I have given many proposals. I have written to many people. I not only have written publicly, but on this AI, by the way, I have had lots of private conversations. I am now disclosing those ideas publicly, most of them. But for a while, I thought I'll just try privately to try and get my message across. But there was no traction. So all I can tell you is what I would like to see. I cannot. But the book points out in details many of the issues of concerning policy that I think we should change. Now, regarding data protection, which is at the heart of this whole thing, I'm glad that Chris Gopalakrishnan is leading a committee, and there are people very involved in that. I'm very glad that, and he's one of the best guys in this in the world. I'm very glad that Niti Aayog is very active in this. But so far, looking at the policies that are publicly available, I think there's a lot more work to be done. And also, there's a big difference between a policy paper, which is a proposal, versus a law. And then there's a big difference between a law and what's being enforced. So what matters is what's being enforced. I point out issues in this book where at the ground level, there are quite a lot of huge problems, huge leakages going on as we speak. And I think to change the thinking of the leaders on a very large scale, at the central level, state level, media level, think tanks, academics, all of that, it's going to take a very long time. And my concern is that this problem is accelerating so fast, India does not have much time. We have to act fast.
If India brings out an AI law in the future, say 2, 3, 5 years from now, will that mean that state gets supreme power over people's personal data?
No, I don't think that's a good idea. I don't think that the Indian government having supreme ownership of people's personal data the way China has is a good idea. I have better proposals than that, and I'm prepared to get into serious discussions on that. These are elaborate topics that will take a while to explain. But I don't think that the way you protect your data is to kind of nationalize data. Nationalization of data would be a bad idea. I'm also not happy with this non-personal or non-private data belonging to a community, because what will happen is, let's say there is a terrorist group and they are a community and they're a certain caste or something. They will say it's nobody else's business to understand us, to pry into us, our lives. All that we are doing is our private data. So, the data privacy belonging to a collective entity can backfire. Because it could ruin national security. It could also encourage communities to become a little cocoon and separatist. And this data owned collectively by a community, a jati, which has a separatist tendency, could actually be dangerous. So the issues are more complex than just, private data and non-private data. Non-private data can be claimed by some community. and government has oversight and owns all the data. I think the issues are far, far more complex. And I really wish well the people who are doing it. They are smart people, but a lot of work has to be done. I do not think that the laws as they presently exist are sufficient.
Moving on from this discourse, which is on data privacy, protection, security, we'll move to one very fascinating chapter of your book. I really enjoyed reading it. And it's around human psyche and thinking. One of the chapters of your book opens with a scary insight, and I'll just paraphrase that. It says that as machines get smarter, growing number of humans are going to become dumber. So do you think AI will manage to hack into human thinking and psychology, human psychology? And is AI the mastermind behind fake news and the ever prevalent confirmation bias?
My book makes a very strong statement. I know it will concern some people, but I want to shake them up so I can discuss it. As machines are getting smarter, people are getting dumber. So let me explain what that means. There is more and more dependence and reliance on Google search, on which posts are prevalent on Facebook, which are the videos that are boosted on YouTube, what does Wikipedia say. People have started shifting their adhikar to these devatas. I call them Google devata, Facebook devata, Twitter devata. These devatas are now the adhikaris. And the average person is bowing down like you bowed to the devatas in the past. Now you're bowing down and saying, oh, Twitter, don't ban me. Don't shadow ban me. I'm a good guy. I'll comply with your protocol. Like you comply with some very scary devata in the past, some deity who wants you to do this sacrifice and don't to do all that. So now in the primitive societies, they used to do blood sacrifice and animal sacrifice and give up all kind of things to please this devata or what they called gods and goddesses in their culture. Now it seems like we are scared. We are scared of Twitter devta. My God, if Twitter devta doesn't like me, I'm in trouble. My whole reputation will go down. They could ruin my reputation. Whereas if Twitter devta likes me, I'll be a hero. My matrimonial value will go up. My job value will go up. My prestige value, my political value will go up. My movies will do better. The whole success of me depends on what this devta thinks of me. So I better be in their good books. So this is ridiculous. I'm calling this the moronization of the masses. Means the masses are becoming morons. The masses are becoming morons, buddhu people, dumbed down, because we are accepting the authority of this kind of an alien new force in our life. And this is discussed in tremendous detail in this book. What is this whole thing about? How they are addicting us, how they are understanding our information, our private data, hacking into our lives, because the natural language processing allows them to understand the meaning of what we are writing. So private messages, whatever I'm writing, posts I'm putting up, they can understand, am I left wing, right wing, am I older, younger person, am I into this movie, that movie, what are my hobbies, who are my friends, what are I like, what makes me angry, what makes me happy. They're understanding and building a very complicated profile. And facial recognition, can allow people to go and look at social media, all the pictures people put up, who you are with. Are you hugging them? Is it a distant relationship? Is it a friendly relationship? Who are your friends and who are your friends' friends? What is the social network? So, and this hacking of emails, looking at the scandals you're involved in, what is some kind of hanky-panky you're doing that could be used for blackmailing you. So this business of understanding a whole population better than social scientists of that country. The AI-based machine learning systems know different communities in India and what are their hot buttons and how they can be mobilized to fight each other. They understand all that psychology better than India's social scientists. This is a shame. Certain individuals, like let's say Prachi, systems understand more about you than your own parents and your good friends. The AI systems know you better than your best friends. I would say in some ways they know you better than you know yourself, because the AI never forgets. It has more memory. So it, all kind of things that you said, and maybe things that you want to deny, things that you don't wish you said, and things that you said long ago that you've forgotten, but AI doesn't forget. So it's able to dig into your psyche and figure you out. And that's what the genius of neural networks, deep learning is all about. And once people understand that they are being hacked and they are voluntarily giving up all this data, they're making a fool of themselves. They're making a fool of themselves. This is the scariest new revelation or scariest thesis part, the scariest part of my thesis that I've exposed in this book, that the machines are getting smarter and people are getting dumber. They're getting dumber because they don't understand that in the garb of giving you free services, free email, free everything, they are the ones who are actually making trillions of dollars. Imagine the richest people in the world today and the largest and richest companies in the world today are giving things free. Wow. Imagine that. Imagine giving things free. Mm-hmm. They're making the maximum amount of money. So why aren't smart people thinking about it? Why aren't smart people able to say, how is this happening? What is the secret? I mean, what is the secret? Mm-hmm. You know, this is brilliant. This is so brilliant that what is happening. But it is making a fool out of the masses. And that is what I'm calling moronization of the masses, meaning make morons out of the masses. I know it's not everybody's very proud and saying, oh, I'm this tough guy and they can't do anything to me. But listen, the point is that they are able to influence what you buy. If they were not able to influence what you buy, the advertising would fail and they would lose money. They would go out of business. The reason these big companies are making money, more money than anybody else ever did, is because of their ability to convince you what to buy. Their ability to convince, if they can convince you what to buy, which holiday to go to, what people, person you should go on a dating or get married to, what kind of a political ideology you should support, they're able to hack your brain. They're able to get into that. They're able to put in fake news to make you do things. They're able to post a certain news, maybe valid, and boost it. And some other news which may be valid, not boosted and even suppress it, they're able to decide what you should be fed given your profile. Given Prachi's profile of what kind of person Prachi is and what she likes, where she'll click, what she will not click, where she's vulnerable. So there is all these algorithms figuring out, okay, how do we hack into Prachi's mind? How do we hack on behalf of a client? There's an advertiser. There's a political party, there may be a church, there may be all kind of people who want the social media to hack into Prachi's mind and make her think a certain way. So the systems, the AI systems are incredibly smart in doing that. And this is something which is a human rights issue. This mm-hmm. is something that affects social policy, not just the political policy, but social policy. And I don't think the leaders of India are sufficiently educated and sufficiently awake to this reality.
Which leads me to a very simplistic question. Why is artificial intelligence so underhyped? If it's under our skin already, why don't we see it? Why can't we feel it? It's everywhere. Why is it underhyped?
So I have a section in my book, mm-hmm. Which is called the aestheticization of power. It's called the aestheticization of power, which means mm-hmm. that this is actually a Marxist theory. They used to interpret how Hitler got into power, and they've used it to interpret many kinds of power, which people accept without fully understanding. So what it's trying to say, and you should read that, is quite complex, quite a detailed theory, which I've explained here. But in a nutshell, there's a certain way to sneak into your life without you knowing it, without you knowing it. It's like, it's called ambient AI, which means it's all over the place. It's always there. Siri is always listening. These cameras are always watching, and they're able to do facial recognition and figure you out. And you're not conscious. It's not like there's an AI guy knocking at the door saying, hey, I'm AI. I'm here to look at you. It's not like that, but it's permeated all your shopping, all your Netflix, what movies you watch, all your messaging that you're doing, all the traffic lights where they're capturing pictures. They are looking for troublemakers and for known criminals and all that through facial recognition. So the use of AI is so ambient. I mean, people don't realize when they use thumbprint to open their phone, that's an AI. Because in the old days, you needed fingerprint experts, and some human being would go do all these measurements, and it would take a few days, then they would match or tell you something about the fingerprint. Nobody needs to do that because AI can figure it out like that. AI can do not only facial recognition, but voice recognition, speech recognition, image recognition, better than human beings, faster than human beings, cheaper than human beings. So this human intelligence of recognizing objects and voices and different kinds of things has been superseded by AI. So this gives the AI system a huge sensory ability, like senses, like harbor senses. AI has got what they call sensors. There are billions of sensors today connected to AI systems, billions. And your camera on your phone is one of them. Where you push, where you click, what you do is transmitted somewhere. Where you are going, the traffic light is, the CCTV camera is doing it. The number of sensors is so huge. And now the bandwidth to bring all of this big data and process it and figure things out is amazing. So this is why it's important for these people to give you free things and look like they're very nice guys. They are very nice guys. We'll give you everything free. Yeah. And, content is free. What else can you want? This is great. You can't afford to be outside this connectivity because then you'll be, nobody will know about you. So you have to join, because once you hit critical mass of people who are members of this kind of a thing, then everybody else has to join. Because if you are not joining, you're an outsider, and you will suffer. So it's very difficult to defeat this system because it's gone too far. And so the ambient, ubiquitous, ever-present AI is there, not only in surveillance, capturing the data about you, but also in using the profile, using the model about you back to influence you. You are both supplying the data to the AI system without knowledge, without being conscious, and you're taking instructions into your subconscious. You're taking instructions on what to do, what not to do. The AI systems are training you. So Prachi is being trained by the system on what you do, what you don't do, what you like. And when you like certain things, you get rewarded, So your rewards are governed by how you behave according to their idea of behavior. So this is a very huge problem. And I'm surprised that people are talking about global warming, which is a serious problem, and climate control. And they're talking about genetically modified foods. And they're talking about water shortage. Those are all very important problems. But AI is a problem that requires as much discourse in society as any of those. But I don't see that.
Yeah, we don't see it either. That's why we are here.
Yeah.
So you've mentioned one major battleground, which is very fascinating. It's about the real clash between algorithms and being. Would you please elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I have a huge, huge called algorithm versus algorithm and being. So. Yeah. I started with a philosophical question. I'm a philosopher by habit, So I started asking as a physics person long ago, as a physicist and then computer scientist, one of the earliest metaphysical questions I've asked myself is the cosmos an algorithm? The whole cosmos is an algorithm. Bhagwan ne algorithm banaya.
Okay.
Is it Bhagwan's algorithm? Because... If you look at how physics says, this is how electron will move in a certain way according to the conditions. So algorithm, the laws of physics for an electron are like an algorithm which the electron is following. It's sort of like nature has algorithms, it seems like. So if the laws of physics are nature's algorithms, in a sense, they're not man-made algorithms, they're nature's own algorithms, we can think of it like that. Then the question is, where is freedom? Because large part of nature is algorithmic. I mean, the planets move a certain way. There are high tide, low tide. There is, all kind of things physics is able to predict certain outcomes very precisely. And that's because nature is behaving in an algorithmic way. It's not random. It's not chaos. It's algorithmic. And these algorithms can be discovered. And then using these algorithms, you can also invent your own machines, your own inventions. So that is what science and technology is all about, is the discovery of nature's algorithms and then using those algorithms to make technology. So then the question is, what about being, the consciousness? Where is consciousness in all this? What is the relationship between consciousness and algorithm? That's what the one of the major issues is. So one of the battlegrounds is unfortunate for me, but I think in my next book, one book after this, I'm showing how to counter that. I'm not giving all the secrets in this book. I am raising issues, but I have a lot more to say than in this book. I'm writing some other books also. So one of the things I'm addressing in the next book has to do with this issue of right now, algorithms are becoming very powerful. Your tradition says that your bliss, your anand, your joy should come from within. You should do yoga, you should do meditation, you should achieve a certain state of consciousness, and that will give you your anand. That is what you should aspire for. That is what your tradition says, my tradition says. I've spent my whole life pursuing that. But now we are approaching a situation where you will be wearing augmented reality goggles, and it will take you on a virtual holiday. It will give you this excitement and that excitement. You will be sitting next to your favorite movie star and having a meal, you will think. And with wearables, you will have more and more experiences. With implants, Elon Musk has got these implants. The US military has got these implants going. China is developing these implants. So with all of this technology, you will be getting a lot of your excitement, your gratification, your desires through external stimulation, through AI-based, machine learning-based mechanisms that have figured you out, that have figured out what you need, when you need, how to make you happy, how to make you dance, how to make you cry, and all that. Yeah. This will have great applications. Some mental health problems will be solved. Depression, bipolar, PTSD in the military. All kind of things will be solved with AI hacking into your brain to give you happy experiences. It will also have huge application for tourism. There will be virtual vacations. You will download a vacation and you will imagine that you're flying in the sky or you've gone to moon or something like that. And so this business of fantasy will happen. Yeah. But as you become more dependent on AI to give you the experiences that you aspire for, you will start aspiring for these experiences. It will be habit forming. What does it do to your practice of yoga? What does it do to your meditation? Do you still need all that? Or maybe you don't even need all that. So some of these AI people are claiming that what the yogis took decades to do and what the rishis took hundreds of years to achieve, we'll plant a chip and give you that experience. So this is kind of artificial rishi in a sense.
Yeah, imagine artificial consciousness.
This is very scary, because what happens to the spiritual movement? What happens to spiritual movement? How do you counter if a guru says you come here, study this and do this practice and this and that, and you get joy? And this AI system being marketed says, listen, you buy these goggles, you wear these gloves, you go do this implant, and actually your life will be very happy. And all your friends who are doing it are saying, yeah, we're enjoying life. This is great. A lot of people will go in that direction. That is the new economy. That is why Apple is selling at such a high multiple. Because it's not 5G, it's because the future, the AI, they are a platform for AI. That is why all these tech companies that are into AI are so rich, because the knowledgeable people know that this is the future of entertainment, this is the future of defense, this is the future of, you know, medical treatment. So as you solve human problems at a certain level using AI, then spirituality is almost like it's out the window. You don't need it. Because the biological model of human beings, the mechanistic model of human beings has won. AI does not need anything to, AI does not depend on knowledge of Advaita Vedanta or Veda. Mm-hmm. It does not. So you see, this is a battle between algorithm and being. This is the ultimate clash of civilizations. The ultimate clash of civilizations we're having right now is AI triggered battleground of, you know, algorithm versus being. So I have a whole lot written in this book on that matter. And I have a subsequent book coming, which takes this further. And I give my solutions. Solution is to stop AI, you're not able to do that. But I have some innovative ideas on how to how the spiritual movement can get ahead with AI also there. This is my thought that for which you'll have to wait for another book.
Are we gradually transferring our prarabdha, our purushartha to machines? Is that the case?
Yeah. So what is happening is, there was a period in history when people used to say everything God is doing. And God is making the rules and I'm just following what God says. Blind obedience to God. Then came this, in Europe came this Renaissance, scientific revolution, liberalism, humanism. The idea was that human is in control of discovery. Humans discover and we have our own values and we come up with the meaning of the world. What is the world all about? We are going to discover it ourselves. It's not some God that some priest told us, but we're going to discover it for ourselves. So this helped for the last 500 years. It brought a lot of discoveries, a lot of science. It moved forward. And now with AI is a kind of a new God. There's a new external authority that's going to tell me what my values should be. So it's almost like, the grand narrative is now becoming an algorithmic grand narrative. It's like an algorithmic grand narrative. This algorithm is going to constantly update and fine-tune the grand narrative, and there'll be a certain version for you and a certain version for other people. So people are becoming almost like slaves. There is a social merit system, like social management system, like karma, which is saying you do good things and the AI system remembers and you get a gift. You'll be sent on holiday. If you run a traffic light or you're doing bad things and your camera showed you're pushing people, and then your application for something will be denied. Some of it you don't even know. Like karma, we say that because of bad karma, I fell down. And because of good karma, I got my lottery, I won a lottery. But I don't really know which karma caused what. I don't know that. Similarly, China has pioneered this social system based on AI, kind of like Chinese government being the managers, the admin for karma. There's a Chinese country karma system that the government is managing your karma, telling you the right karma, wrong karma, giving you points, telling you what your prarabdha is, what phala you'll get for if you do this karma, what's the fruit of that, so and so on. Now, you can't take it trivially because China is exporting this to Pakistan. The Pakistani military is controlling the karma of the citizens to keep themselves in power. And China has sent this surveillance system to Zimbabwe as an example put all these thousands of cameras and with facial recognition and natural language processing, they are helping the dictators stay in power and oppress the people. So what you are finding is China is spreading its footprint for this kind of a technology, which will allow it to decide who's going to rule. Who's going to rule in Pakistan? Who's going to be defeated? Because China has the weapon to secure their authority. And if China doesn't like this particular ruler, they can get him out because they have scandals on him. They know all the scandals on him and they know how to compromise him also, how to blackmail him. So he'll stay honest. So this is why in this book I say, like the Rajas were made to fight each other by the British, because the British knew how to make one win and how to make one lose. The British knew all the secrets. The British knew your vulnerabilities, your weaknesses, and the British used it to win over all of them. So now I see these people in USA, some of these big AI companies, and I see people in China playing this game with the whole world. And so the future is challenging. I want people who are smart like you to wake up and figure this out and help. I'm trying to figure this out. I need good interns like you, many of them, because we have to not give up. We have to outsmart this whole thing on behalf of our civilization. And keep our civilization moving forward properly.
That's quite nice and reasonable. So one last question. Given all of this, given that we are already partially enslaved by AI, what is your message for the youth of India specifically?
So I think the youth of India should become psychologically strong. My problem is that they're too weak. They don't want to know the truth, the facts, if it's uncomfortable. They want to just feel good and go into escapism. I have so many people who say, Rajiv sir, why are you spoiling my feel good? I mean, rather than I feed them what they'll make them feel good. But you know, the crisis that we face as humanity, not just India, but here as humanity, is multifaceted. We have so many other problems. AI is actually helping solve some of those problems and helping make some of those problems worse. AI is a mind amplifier. It's like it amplifies your mind. Like a car amplifies your physical body, like a machine amplifies your physical body. And so whatever you could do now with that machine, you could do better. So similarly, AI amplifies your mind. It gives you more memory. It gives you more capability. You can track more things. You can figure out more algorithms. So the AI can be used by a good mind for good things, and it can be used by a bad mind for bad things. This is true. And so the balance between good and bad people is going to be disrupted, because here comes a weapon. Somebody will know how to use it. Somebody will not know how to use it. You see, so each time a new device comes, the equilibrium between opposing forces gets disrupted, because they don't have equal use of it. Some people have more use of it, some people have less use of it. So I want the youth of India to become very knowledgeable, not only this technical job of writing programs in AI and doing low-level work, which a lot of people are doing, but become very conscious of the social implications. What are the social implications? How does it affect your culture? How does it affect the politics? How does it affect conflicts? Will somebody else be deciding that I'm going to fight with you, and because they'll put in some message that will make me angry at you, you know, and make me suspicious about you? So who's going to do the divide and rule of the future, like the British did the divide and rule of the Rajas to fight each other? So India, the young people of India are very smart, but they are sleeping. They need to wake up, and they need to become more aware of all this, take charge. And I would love to have more people like you who want to be interns. I would love to have regular Zoom Hangouts, Google Hangouts, whatever Hangouts you want. Once the COVID is gone and we are vaccinated, I'd love to come to India and have hundreds of gatherings. I want to do all that for the youth of India. My book is dedicated to the young scientists and technocrats. Because they are the future. And this is your future. It's not my future, because I'll be gone. Okay, nothing going to affect me. I'm okay. But it is your future. And therefore, you have to take control of that future.
Okay. Thank you so much for spending your time and speaking with me and sharing all these insights from your new book. I really hope more and more people, I wouldn't say like me, but yeah, more and more youth of India get motivated, get access, get a copy of your book, basically.
So I want to say that if you go to www.aiandpower.com, aiandpower.com, aiandpower.com, that's the book website. It'll give you, we're populating it with more and more information. Right now there's only some information, but we'll put up more videos and we'll put up more stuff, and it'll tell you how to buy. You can buy in India, you can buy in UK, you can buy in USA, you can buy a Kindle copy. All of that, it'll tell you. So it's one-stop shopping for all the information about artificial intelligence, the future of power, the future of society, and the future of you.
Okay.
Thank you so much. And I just want to remind my listeners, I love these conversations with bright young people. And so do not, she may be a little shy and so on, but I'm telling you, she's very smart. I've talked to her quite a lot before accepting her as my intern. And so, if you are a person who has a tremendous interest, good work ethic, hard working, want to understand these things, want to join, then you can contact me by email. And namaste to all of you.